adjustments to the gun had to be gone through every single time. So it was a cumbersome exercise, and it was very difficult to achieve the kind of sustained accuracy which you need to make an artillery bombardment effective.
In action, the gun wrought terrible damage and remained in action until the Allies broke through the Gustav Line. But with the fall of Cassino to Allied forces in March 1944, the Gustav Line was effectively broken, and the Allies stormed north to relieve the Anzio beachhead. They did this by rapidly moving north, not along the coastal route, but inland, which cut off the railway lines that would have provided the big guns with their escape route. The guns were captured almost intact and ready to move out. One gun was damaged by its crew before capture, but the other was found almost complete, and this example was later shipped to the United States for examination and test firing. It still sits at the Aberdeen Proving Grounds in Maryland, USA. At divisional level, the standard Wehrmacht division of World War II deployed more and heavier artillery pieces than their opponents.
On paper, in theory, a fully equipped German infantry division had a regiment of artillery at its disposal. It was quite a large regiment of artillery, as German divisional artillery regiments went. It had four Abteilung, four subdivisions of guns, and it had, at full strength, at the beginning of the war, 48 guns to support the division. Later in the war, the establishment was changed, and there were fewer guns. It went down to about 42 guns for a full-strength German division. But the key point to keep in mind was that throughout the Second World War, there was a tremendous problem keeping the divisional artillery up to full strength. And very often, German divisional artillery regiments did not have as many guns as they were supposed to have.
The first weapon to be issued to the German army after World War I was the 7.5-centimeter LELG-18. It was a light, sturdy piece of equipment that used an unusual form of construction. The barrel was carried in a rectangular casing, which was hinged into another, which carried the fixed breech block and firing mechanism. The whole process was similar to that of a shotgun breech, and though unusual, it was fast and simple. The carriage was a simple box trailer with a shield. The wheels were either wooden spoked and iron rimmed for horse-drawn models, or steel disc with pneumatic tires if it were designed to be drawn by truck. These first guns were used extensively throughout the war, but their use tended to decline towards the end of the war when increasingly heavier weapons were needed. One solution was the 10.5-centimeter howitzer, which were in use in large numbers during the early war years. Initially, they gave the German divisional artillery the edge over nearly all their opponents, most of whom used obsolete World War I equipment with a maximum 7.5-centimeter caliber.
The German infantry division gained the backbone of its artillery support from the 105-millimeter FH-18 field howitzer. This was often a horse-drawn equipment, although in certain units it was transported by a German artillery half-track. In most units it was in fact horse-drawn. A German infantry division could rely on three batteries of these 105 field howitzers, supported by another battery of heavier guns, 150mm field howitzers, and also 100mm guns. So a fair degree of fire support, but very conventional in fact in its general makeup and organisation.
But as the war went on, more modern opponents in the shape of the British 25PR or 8.5-centimeter weapon and the deceptively powerful Soviet 7.6-centimeter guns, which showed that the 10.5-centimeter howitzers could be outranged without undue difficulty, even by smaller caliber weapons. The events of the Russian winter campaign of 1941 to 42 exposed the other major shortcoming of the German guns. The alternate cycle of frost and thaw during that winter reduced the rough roads that supplied the Eastern Front into quagmires. In going like this, the heavy German howitzers could make only slow progress. Many were lost during that winter of 1941 to 42, simply because they got stuck fast in frozen mud during the retreat and could not be moved.
An infantry division's artillery in the German army at the beginning of the Second World War was generally horse-drawn. And it moved at about the same walking pace as a foot-borne infantry soldier. So the artillery of a division was no more mobile than the soldiers in the division. And it was drawn slowly by horses. It relied on horse fodder and horse water for transport rather than for petrol. And outside of certain particular applications, such as mountain divisions, the infantry division artillery was quite slow at the beginning of the war. Later on in the war, it became necessary to motorize the artillery of a division. And infantry division artillery started to be towed by petrol-powered tractors.
In the panzer divisions, the guns were generally drawn by half-tracks, large artillery half-tracks. And on occasion, if a panzer division was lucky, it might get an allocation of either Hummels or Vesps, which were self-propelled artillery. But in the main, for the standard German infantry division, it was horse-drawn artillery throughout the war.
Where the problems really came were in not so much in Western Europe, where there were good roads, so for the fall of Poland and France, there wasn't much to encounter. And those were all fought in the summer or the early summer. Where the real problems came, of course, was in Russia. There were no good roads, and there were these tremendous seasons of mud and snow and ice and all of the conditions that make moving heavy artillery probably one of the worst things you can imagine. The guns would sink up to their axles or past their axles in mud. They would need an enormous amount of horse and manpower to draw them out of there. Sometimes it just wasn't practical, in which case they would stay stuck in the mud until the mud froze, at which point it froze rock solid, and again they couldn't move it. So the mobility issue was a huge one for the German army in Russia. The front line would move up to 1,500 miles away from Berlin and then move all the way back. So there were big distances that people were covering. At the start of Operation Barbarossa, for example, the German army in Russia had 625,000 horses on the staff in order to pull the gun. So it was by no means the kind of armoured juggernaut of legend, and that certainly slowed down the infantry divisions.
Despite the initial success, the invasion of the Soviet Union in 1941 revealed many of the limitations of the German medium artillery arm. The previous 2 years of war had seemed to indicate that their artillery weapons were adequate. As the winter of 1941 turned into the thaw of 1942, it was painfully obvious that the German artillery pieces were cumbersome and lacked range as opposed to their Soviet equivalents. New designs were in the works, but the gunners in the front line had to do something to counter their opponents, and the easiest solution was to simply use as much captured Soviet material as possible. During the Great Attack in 1941, so many Soviet guns and howitzers were captured that the Germans were able to transport large numbers across Europe to bolster the Atlantic wall defenses and to equip the artillery formations in France and Italy. Russian artillery even saw service with the Africa Corps in the desert. These German gunners are using captured Russian 76mm guns. Compared with the relatively few types of equipment taken into the field by many of the Allied armies, the size and scope of German medium and heavy artillery formations were too diverse and varied to be supplied easily. The presence of large numbers of captured guns didn't help. Although the logistical situation deteriorated over the course of the war, the training and skill of the German gun teams meant that the German artillery remained a formidable opponent throughout the war, despite the confusion which was caused by the large variety of guns in service.